watch this next video, and we'll talk about it in a moment.
So would you, again, consider this to be a non-aggressive movement by Mr. King?
At this time, no, I wouldn't.
It is aggressive?
Yes, it's starting to be. This foot is laying flat. There's starting to be a bend in this leg, and his buttocks area started to rise, which would put us at the beginning of our spectrum again.
So I want to focus on line 8 here. It says there's starting to be a bend in this leg, in his butt. The buttocks area has started to rise, which would put us at the beginning of our spectrum again. Brief note on physics. If someone hits you, if someone hits me right here, right this, I'm going to have a reaction. Because I've been hit, I've been pushed, my body will move. Now, in regards to Rodney King being beaten with batons, police batons, he says, you know, there's starting to be a bend in this leg. He's coding the movement, the reaction of being hit, not as a reaction of being hit, but rather an interpretation of this being a move to become aggressive. In his butt, the buttocks area has started to rise. Again, not as a reaction from being hit, but showing that there's premeditation there, that his buttocks area begins to rise and begins to be a bend in his foot because he's about to do something aggressive, and hence justifying that, you know, in that assessment period, justifying why he needs to be beaten again. But they would not use the word beaten. They've coded it as there has to be an escalation. Okay, so Sergeant Dukes, the LAPD expert on the use of force by the police, he's considered a very important witness. Now, he's coded King's body movements into categories of aggression or cooperation. And the prosecutor has tried to make the case that the tape demonstrates that at this point, King is being cooperative. And if he can establish this hitting him again as unjustified, and the officers therefore should be found guilty of the crimes they are charged with. But to rebut the vision that Rodney King was being cooperative, as proposed by the prosecutor, Sergeant Duke instead uses the semantic resources provided by language to code those movements as aggressive, extremely subtle body movements of a man lying prone on this asphalt. So really focus on that line 18. The category systems that the defense uses, every one of King's movements is reinterpreted, reperceived as aggressive, which in turn justifies that escalation of force. Any body twist, the bend, it's not gonna be out of pain, it's because he's starting to do something. So using that coding scheme to animate the events being studied, the expert teaches the jury, this is very important, the expert is teaching the jury how to look at the tape, how to see relevant events within it. Similar to how I am teaching you how to see relevant events within language, within a transcript, within discourse, how to see the passive voice, how to see the active voice, how to understand what's going on, the theogram reversal of speech. We're socializing each other into understanding. In a different way, Sergeant Duke, the expert witness brought on, is socializing the jury how to see and how to perceive the tape, such that it is no longer this objective, you know, self-evident piece of evidence. No. Sergeant Duke is socializing the jury how to see from the police's perspective. Okay, the expert provides, therefore, the jury with an ethnography of seeing that situates the events visible on the tape within the perceptual frameworks of a particular profession. It's professional vision. The ethnographer is not an outside anthropologist, but an actual member of the community whose work is being explicated. So the jury is being brought into the fold. You can see here, Sergeant Duke analyzing with, you know, his wand here to point out Rodney King's body and understanding how to see what the police must have been seeing in that moment, and that they were doing careful police work because there's the bend, there's beginning to be a bend in the leg. Okay. Now, with all of this was just going on, what we see here is a constant highlighting. The person who's being noted is Rodney King. Rodney King is being highlighted as an aggressive actor, which was also achieved by the use of graphic representation. So we have the coding scheme. We see highlighting with how language is being used to highlight what Rodney King's doing. They did it also with a graphic representation of his body. So here's a very blurry image. You can see police cars. You see light figures lit in different ways. Now, at the very beginning, while the camera was still slightly out of focus, Mr. King ran towards the officers. as a result of the electrical shock from Sergeant Koon. So if you're moving, your body is going to do things involuntarily and move forward. Now, rather than, again, this kind of reactions of physics, if you're being electrified from it, if you're being tased, or if you're being hit, or if you're being beaten, your body will have reactions to it. Rather than seeing it and coding it as that, these interpretations, those body movements were recoded and reperceived as something else. So being tased, that was then called by the defense. It was coded as a charge. A charge. Now, a charge, if we go back to every word has a flavor, has a taste, it, you know, connotes a generation, it connotes a particular field of experience. A charge is a very active verb. To charge at someone is also aggressive. So you're using these codes, these aggressive codes, to paint Rodney King in a particular way. Now, it's difficult to see on the tape any type of running or activity. You don't know who's doing what. So what they do is they take in this tape, they break down this in from one frame into multiple frames, and they highlight his body in white lines so that you can see Rodney King and you don't really see anything else that's going on. So they break this down into multiple frames, and then they show his, like, moment by moment, frame by frame movement of his body. Okay, they're clearly highlighting it, but they're also doing something else. When you highlight something else, when you highlight one thing, there's other things not attended to. Something comes to the foreground, other things move to the background. What are you focusing on the entire time? Rodney King. Who are you seeing there? Rodney King. Because you're supposed to. You're supposed to forget the police. Because if you change the way that you look at things, the things you look at change. The defense had portrayed King as both a cunning martial arts expert, scanning the scene to plot his next move, buttocks move by buttocks move, and as a man who's also crazed by drugs. He's a cunning martial arts expert who's thinking and calculating, but also crazed by drugs. And instead, the prosecution argued that he was simply a man being beaten who fell helplessly to the ground. So you have one who's made him into a mastermind martial arts expert and a drugged, crazed human. And the other one saying he was a man who's being beaten who then fell helplessly to the ground. All right. Though most of the evidence used in the two trials was the same in the sense that they're using the tape, the prosecutors in the second trial were able to build discursively their own interpretive frameworks to counter those that had been so effective in the first trial, all right, and thus provide the jury different ways of looking at the tape that was not available to the first jury. Because we're all in different professions, we all have different trainings, so we're seeing things differently, and the jury, the first time, the defense was very successful in providing for the jury an interpretation that you forget you're even dealing with police officers. You can really only focus on the aggressive, charging, cunning martial arts man of Rodney King. Let's look at those white lines and the description of it.
But when Rodney King, in the very beginning, in the first 6 frames of this incident, went from the ground to a charge, and Sergeant Koon will tell you this is his rendition of what he saw, this is how he perceived it. But once he saw Rodney King rise to his feet and attack at Powell, that in Koon's mind, in charge of his officers, that Rodney King has set the tone. Rodney King was trying to get in that position.
By virtue of the coding schemes introduced by the defense to those in that courtroom, including the jury, they're no longer focusing their attention on the blows of the police officers, but instead they're all brought to analyze this minute detail of the body behavior of the victim in order to determine if it counts as aggressive. So it's that foreground, background thing. They're not thinking about the fact that it's the police officers on trial for excessive force. No, that's gone. Now it's just about, what was Rodney King doing? What's his body doing? In those assessment periods, his buttocks did rise. And because those things were coded as aggressive, and then that became the language of the courtroom, there was no other interpretation strong enough to dismantle the one of the defense. Let's look at one more video. Or actually, you can take a look at the transcript yourself on your own, but hit one more video.
Starting the video at 4:27:08. That would be the position you'd want him in, is that correct?
Not with the way he is. He is, his leg is bent in this area, having moved in this hand here being straight up and down, that causes me concern.
Does it also cause you concern that someone stepped on the back of his neck?
No, it does not.
So, it's the expert here is the one who has the authority to speak, an expert witness. And he talks about the perception of the police officer. The prosecutor asks, that would be the position you'd want him in. Is that correct, Sergeant Duke? The expert says, no, not with the way he is. I mean, his leg is bent in this area and points. Had he moved his hand here being straight up and down, I mean, that causes me concern. Prosecutor, again, trying to point out that like people are going to react when if someone's stepping on your neck, your other parts of your body is probably going to react in pain. Maybe, you know, it's just the natural thing that a body will do. Sergeant Duke codes this as, you know, something that causes him concern. So the implication here is that someone steps on your neck, someone tases you, someone beats you with batons, and your body's supposed to just be limp and do nothing, and only at that state would then the police officer be justified to do nothing. But so long as there are physical reactions, they all get coded as aggressive, and therefore warrants more of the beating, more of the stepping on the neck, whatever it might be. So, but that's not what the prosecution, there's also limitations within the courtroom discourse, but what prosecution can do and not lead the witness or the expert testimony here. So right, the prosecutor says, does it also cause you concern that someone stepped on the back of his neck? Sergeant Duke, no, it does not. Okay, there are more videos to analyze here in this court case, but I think the point has been made. The ability to build and interpret a material cognitive artifact, whether it be an archaeological map, which is embedded within an archaeological map, be in the courtroom, be it discourse in another space, it's all within this really complex web of socially articulated discourse. The ability, therefore, to see is to see relevant entities is lodged not in the individual mind, but is instead within a community of competent practitioners. We're not seeing anything without knowing what it is that we're seeing, and that the thing that we're looking at is a conversation within a community, and we are all putting our vantage point onto it. And the discourse that emerges is the final word, the final say of it, and especially when we're dealing with the court, which is the jury is going to deliberate with the evidence that is given and has to deal with it as it is presented. And in this particular case, they couldn't see the police officers anymore. They saw Rodney King as an aggressive man who had charged. That's what they were told to see. It was very, very careful, manipulative for sure, but that's exactly their job as the defense, is to tailor the evidence so that you only see what the defense wants you to see. And the officers were acquitted. A year later, the prosecution learns from its mistakes and reframes differently, and two out of the four are prosecuted. When we think about the acts of violence against black and brown bodies, black and brown human beings from the police, we have to also understand how the police are trained to see those beings. What is the community of practice? What is the discourse going on in those communities such that people are framed and coded? And what's the language around that when we get to the courtroom? People keep asking for officers to be arrested. But what about once they get arrested and they go to the courts? What are those lawyers using? How are they using that video to describe what's going on. Hopefully they've learned from the Rodney King trial and they will no longer think of these videos as self-evident, because they're not self-evident. And they will be dissected, slowed down, framed. These human beings are going to be described in ways which will show justification of escalation and de-escalation, because stepping on a neck isn't a new practice within the police. That's an old one. You can see it there in the early 90s, and probably earlier there. But then using the reaction of the body from being hit from a baton or step on the neck as justification for further submission and more escalation of force. So we're really dealing with very complex perceptual fields here. And when we get to the point of socializing the jury into a particular vision, I mean, these are the discourses that shape our lives. Whose narrative wins? And when we're in a courtroom, the jury at the end is going to decide based on the evidence given. So you can, it's very clear cut there. But in our everyday lives, do the conversations about whose vision is going to be contested, who has the right to speak, what authority do you have, and we kind of like battle it out in social media, in our own worlds of our lives. I mean, we do this all the time, figuring out which vision will rise to the top and become the narrative for whatever we're looking at. There's so much to talk more about, and I hope we have more opportunity to do so later in class and office hours. Anyway, I look forward to hearing your questions, and I'll see you on Thursday for the live class. Bye.
A black man was hung today from a tree.